Good morning again, everybody. Welcome to this webinar of the EPIC project. Most of you know me, but for those of you who don't know me yet, my name is Patricia Martinez. I'm project manager at the European Association for Information for Local Development, AEIDL, based in Brussels. And I represent one of the 16 partners that are member of the EPIC project, the European Platform of Integrating Cities that is funded by the European Union's Asylum, Migration and Integration Fund. Well, today, as you all know, 20th of June, we celebrate the World Refugee Day. It's the occasion to honor the strength and the courage of refugees and encourage public awareness and support of the people who had to flee their homes. Humanitarian refugee crisis are terms that have been receiving a lot of media attention during the last few years, and maybe especially in the last months since the Russian invasion of Ukraine in February. And a war that has so far provoked nearly 6 million refugees fleeing Ukraine. We have seen how in this particular occasion, the European Union decided to activate in March this year the Temporary Protection Directive for the first time since it was created. And this was a decision that maybe surprised many observers who were wondering if the European Union would be able to provide a coordinated response this time to the refugee crisis. And that for sure has not been the same approach followed in previous years with other wars or with other conflicts such as those in Syria, in Venezuela, or in Afghanistan, to mention some. Of course, we know that the figure of worldwide refugees is much higher than these 6 million people already displaced from Ukraine. According to United Nations, every minute there are 20 people in the world leaving everything behind to escape war, persecution, or terror. And this year, the figure has achieved the 100 million people for the first time on record, with the majority of the refugees, as we know, being housed in developing countries. Well, why all this? In the EPIC project, we are a network of local authorities and NGOs, and we've been speaking in previous sessions, in previous webinars, about how local initiatives are fostering migrants integration and working to build a more inclusive narrative. For instance, we've been speaking a lot on how to design and implement alternative or counter narrative campaigns locally. And in today's webinar, while we want to keep speaking about the importance and the very often leading role that local authorities and grassroots initiatives at the forefront play in responding to crisis and in welcoming migrants and refugees, we also want to speak and to debate with all of you about the role that the different institutions and the individuals across the different governance levels play. Whether the current humanitarian crisis in Ukraine might change public perception or migration policies or not. And also how we can ensure that in all this, the voices of the migrants and the refugees themselves are actually put at the center. So before we start giving the floor to our panelists and start the debate with you, just a few of basic housekeeping rules. Please remember to mute and unmute yourself if you are not speaking. To our dear audience participants, feel free to ask your questions and comment in the chat box that you have at the bottom of your screen, and we will have the time to address them at the end of each intervention, or you might also want to click on the raise hand button to take the floor during the Q&A. And lastly, just to mention that as you've seen, the webinar is being recorded for communication purposes only. So if you don't know ways to appear in the screen, just please don't turn it on. Okay, so now without further ado, I would like to welcome our first keynote speaker, who is Marco Ricorda. Marco is a political and institutional communication expert active in European and international affairs. Hello, Marco, good morning. Well, Marco, you also work as the communication officer in the International Center for Migration and Policy Development in the Mediterranean, that is based in Malta. And you have worked for different European Union institutions as communication expert for the ALDE group or for the cabinet of the former president of the European Parliament, Antonio Tajani. And today we have asked you to address a very significant topic for what we've been working on EPIC and in this World Refugee Day, that is the migration narratives across the three levels of the governance for migration and how these actors operate at the different level or how they interact among them. So welcome, Marco, and please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Patricia, and thank you to everyone who is taking the time today to attend this webinar. Coincidentally, we organized a large forum in Seville last week about this very issue, about urban migration governance, in which we stressed significantly the role of communication and narratives in shaping migration policy making. I will speak today in a personal capacity. I want to make this very clear. It also helps me have a more frank debate to all of you. And I will only refer to communicating migration rather than migration policy at large. Now, when we discuss the narratives that develop, when talking about migration at different levels of governance, I'd like to share with you something I learned very recently. A couple of months ago, Pope Francis came to Malta, and his intervention spoke openly in favor of migrants and encouraged the embrace of Europe of Ukrainian refugees that, as you know, and as Patricia mentioned earlier, are fleeing war following the Russian invasion into their country. And he made a very interesting comparison between an episode of the Bible, which happened in Malta, which is the shipwreck of St. Paul, which happened on this island in 60 AD. And during his visit at the Halfar Peace Lab, which is a notorious today welcome and reception center for asylum seekers and refugees, the pontiff basically gave a press conference and said that today we see another kind of shipwreck. We see what he calls the shipwreck of civilization, which threatens not only migrants, but all of us as European and as human beings. How can we save ourselves from this shipwreck, which risks sinking the ship of our civilization? A very poetic intervention. And the answer to this question was by conducting ourselves with kindness and humanity, by regarding people not merely as statistics or numbers for what they really are. They are people, they're men, they're women, they're brothers, they're sisters, their sons, their daughters, each and every one with their life story. For me, as a communication analyst, this is very important because most of migration narratives today, at all levels of governance, whether it is international, national, and local, which I'm going to go through in a few minutes, are mostly about numbers. But numbers don't matter that much. And certainly, absolute numbers are not very powerful in communicating migration policy or certain narratives when it regards the lives of many. So what are narratives? Let's make a premise. What are narratives and why do they matter? I think today what I can see in the numerous interventions I give every year is that there is a lot of confusion between what the communication is, what campaigns are, and what narratives are. So allow me to tell you a bit more about that before we go a little deeper into the matter. When referring to migration policy making, narratives are regularly mentioned as some of the most important determinants of public attitudes, behavior, and even sources of perception or sometimes misperceptions, as in the case of numbers. They are To give a proper definition, they are selective representations of reality. Let me tell you this again. They are selective, so they are selected representations of reality. They are pretty much necessary to decipher, explain, and simplify what we call complex realities. A simpler definition away from the academia would be the way we perceive and speak about migrants and migration at large. That's how we can define a narrative. Something that might be surprising to some of you, or may not, is that in Europe, on a macro scale, attitudes to immigration are not becoming more negative. Rather, they are notably, over the past 10 years, very stable, and in recent years, they even become more positive. I would say that, on a personal note, that the recent outpouring support to welcome Ukrainian refugees in Europe is a clear manifestation of these positive attitudes to immigration. And therefore, as an analyst, I find it a little sometimes unnecessary to overly work on the dangers about anti-immigration narratives, because we see that the attitudes are mostly positive. And we should focus more on things that we have in common instead of focusing on the extremes of the migration debate. Narratives, anyway, are very complex, relational, multifaceted, and I have to say today, 2022, significantly understudied. They are always seen as something secondary to migration policy. They can be produced, reproduced, crafted, and revised. And they can include assumptions about causality, good and bad, responsibility, and consequences. But let's look at who are the actors participating in the construction of prevailing narratives in Europe. How do, for instance, state and non-state actors take part in the crafting and dissemination of narratives? So I mentioned it earlier, when talking about migration narratives, identify three main levels of governance, very often unrelated and hardly ever communicated with each other: the international level, the national level, and the local level. And I'm very happy to see that this organization is focusing on the local level mostly, but I'm going to give you some pointers on how your messages at the local level can reverberate into higher levels of governance. So let's look at them. The first one pertains to international organizations mostly, very important players in the design and implementation of migration policies, such as the European Union or the United Nations. What type of narratives do they craft? What are the key elements of such narratives? At large, I can identify that international organizations, which by definition operate at the intersection of nation states, tend to reflect their vision on how cross-border or internal mobility should be managed. Their approach to narratives include diverse elements intertwining with each other, such as, for instance, mostly a positive appreciation of migration as a natural, human, historical phenomenon that reference to universal principles, mostly in Europe we refer to as human rights, and an emphasis on the benefits of migration for both host societies and migrants, regardless of their status. In this realm, migration narratives are influenced, and this is something I write substantially about, and it's going to come out in a more substantial publication soon, what I call the silos effect, something that you should be aware of. Among the internal departments of international organizations, such as directorates working on migration and directorates working in development cooperation or communication. And most controversially, these narratives are highly impacted, if some of you are in Brussels, might know this term, by what I call communication bubbles. Basically, places where like-minded people, usually international staff working in specific neighborhoods of cities hosting international organizations, like Brussels, Geneva, Washington, D.C., and so on, create narratives that are very detached from the realities of the majority of citizens of their host countries and seem utterly unable to analyze, conceive, or even acknowledge how alternative narratives develop. Migration is probably one of the most distorted topics affected by the communication bubbles effect for two reasons. First one is that the same implementers of such narratives are usually called expats. They're not migrants, they're expats, which is a term that indicates their non-attachment or temporary attachment to their host city. Expat means expatriate, which means in Latin, outside of the motherland. So there is this basically sense of detachment from the host country where these people live in, a category that I belong to for over a decade. Secondly, these people tend to make the most out of migration. They're usually those people that, because of their choices, because of their circumstances, they tend to make the most out of migration. Therefore, they tend highly to underestimate value-based communication toward audiences that do not share the same values, such as universalism and benevolence. And frankly, in my experience, they are less equipped to communicate to groups that value other things, such as tradition, conformity, or security. Together with international organizations, I should also mention international NGOs that shape migration narratives too, mainly by forging stories whose purpose is combating the securitization discourse, carried out most of the times by political movements that exploit the salience of the phenomenon of migration for electoral purposes. This is highly documented in a lot of studies produced by the Migration Policy Center that I will be happy to share with you afterwards. Now let's move to another level of governance, which is the national level. States and national governments are the central actors when it comes to storytelling of migration and policy implementation. In this framework, at least in Europe, migration is mainly depicted as a challenge, or mostly, and I say as a commentator, unfortunately, as a crisis. Very often migration communication is associated to crisis communication, which for me is a big problem and one of the things that should be discussed in this type of forum. Yeah, so basically, at the state level, migration is mostly depicted as a crisis, in response to which quick and practical solutions have to be put forward or presented. And in this context, we have witnessed recently elements of contrast between, with regards to two different types of migration influxes. For instance, a number of political leaders of usually extreme fringes, and I don't want to say extreme right specifically, I want to say extreme fringes overall, try to capitalize on the emotional feature of the discourse of migration related to sub-Saharan Africa and the Middle East by fueling anti-immigration narratives. And this, for instance, happened in particular at the very outset, 2 years ago, of the COVID-19 pandemic. However, many commentators, and it was discussed also by Patricia today, not all I agree with, now discuss, do not only debunk, but discuss how the same actors are openly doing the very opposite towards narratives of millions of Ukrainians, 6 million to date, fleeing into neighboring countries. The salience of migration, which is the importance into the policy agenda in political discussions, contributes to such emotional activation. This is why state narratives tend to be securitarian and tend to be shaped by what? By irregular or uncontrolled immigration, not by migration as such overall, which is a very comprehensive and vast phenomenon. The more distorted and the more unbalanced a narrative is, the more states corner themselves into a deeper cul-de-sac, where they no longer dictate how the narrative frames their policies, but rather it becomes the narrative that drives them and dictates their policies. This we see it all the time, and it's mostly at the state level. When a narrative is uncontrolled and polarized, meaning that when migration is discussed between yes migration, no migration, and there is a debate at the center, political leaders that in a very fast communication environment need to be present at all time are pushed to giving very quick solutions that often are not the most optimal. Therefore, we can see how the communication along migration is driving them into a way that impairs their ability to make policies. And what about the local levels? What about the work that AEIDL is doing when it comes to the storytelling of migration? And I mean also the ADL as a network and only as an organization. What is the role of cities in forging migration narratives? Is it possible to scale up local narratives by giving them prominence at the international level? Let's make something very clear. Cities, local authorities, local governments, due to their proximity to citizens, are in a unique position to foster a pragmatic, evidence-driven debate on migration, which is imperative not only to raise awareness in local communities, but also to adopt effective inclusion policies. Local initiatives can successfully resonate at the international level, and the expertise of cities can bring added value for all. I think that there is a higher chance for migration narratives to be pushed up from the local level onto the national and international level rather than the opposite. Why is that? Because of the proximity to citizens, to policymakers. Still, the European debate is a lot about the bridging the gap between citizens and policymakers, between citizens at all of all territories of Europe onto Brussels. We are still debating about that. The same applies to migration. A local story, a local situation, a local circumstance, a local policy resonates a lot stronger than a national policy when it comes to the effects of immigration, whether it is controlled or uncontrolled, whether it is properly managed or improperly managed into their citizens. Therefore, local authorities have a higher chance to influence the narratives rather than national and international level. Now, I cannot only point out problems, I need to provide a solution. So the main solution would be to try and speak with one voice across, not only horizontally at different levels of governance, but vertically. So try to bridge this gap between the three levels. Basically, there are many issues at stake when it comes to the impact of migration policy and migration narratives into policymaking. One of these is definitely the cleavage between international, national, and local level of governance, which translate into a fragmented and multifaceted discourse. This is why I say there isn't a migration narrative. There are infinite migration narratives. So specific attention should be given to this fragmentation in order to foster fruitful discussions among the different actors involved. How can we do that? Firstly, by promoting investment in thematic research, specifically focusing on how these levels interact. There is nothing today out there, apart from a short blog post that I authored a few months ago, which I think is the reason why Patricia called me here. There is nothing on this topic today online. Secondly, by promoting fora such as this one, with the aim of enhancing common understanding between the actors at stake while improving multi-level governance. So if you're doing an event about communicating migration, make sure you get a representative from an international organization, from a country, and from a local authority, in order for them to bring a debate that can really show their own concerns in their daily work. And thirdly, these efforts should be monitored, evaluated, and revised to align with current realities. To conclude, the current Ukrainian refugee crisis has triggered, as I said earlier, a remarkable and unprecedented outpouring of support. In fact, the attitudes and actions towards Ukrainians fleeing the war appears to be somehow aligned both at the international, national, and local level. There has been a network of cities in Poland, in Romania, in Slovakia that have mobilitated their efforts in order to provide housing straight away. And the same thing happened at the national level. Recently, I was at an event where I was supposed to discuss this topic, and the Polish ambassador to the UK, the event was in London, referred to Ukrainians not as migrants, but as guests. So we can see that at least now there is an alignment between the different narratives. However, I want you to be very wary, because what we have seen with Syria and Turkey, for instance, or we have seen in other parts of Europe, mostly Southern Europe, in the first arrival of refugees, not in 2015, but within the first Arab Spring. And the same can be applied to the refugee crisis of the Balkans in the 90s during the Balkan War, where people moved mostly to Italy and Central Europe mostly Germany, Austria, and Switzerland, there is something that is going to happen for sure. Solidarity will get consumed. Solidarity doesn't last forever. So what is true now, you can see, is that why these attitudes are stable on a macro level, they will not necessarily remain stable, because European hospitality will, in my opinion, for sure, wear out. Why is that? Because you have narratives of solidarity, but then you have the real problems: housing, integration, inclusion in the job market, education, adaptation of large influxes of people in a very short span of time, which usually is faster than legislation. So narratives can help you until a certain point, but if narratives are not backed by policy making that reflects the circumstances, you're going to end up in a big integration and inclusion disaster, and tensions will arise. So this is why promoting a solid understanding between the actors involved in the storytelling of migration, as well as developing common knowledge about the diverse implications and effects of migration narratives of policymaking, must be encouraged and pursued at all levels of governance. I will conclude here my intervention, and I'm looking forward to hearing some of your questions. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Marco, for this very inspiring keynote speech. Indeed, we know that solidarity and the salience for the solidarity doesn't remain at the top level, and it has limitation. I think it's very positive that you started your intervention mentioning how actually the perception that the Europeans have about migration is not negative, but rather has been stable or going positive. I think that a lot of citizens might have a different impression. Maybe it's because the polarized debate in the media, or because some people that exacerbate this debate has been occupying a lot the public space, and we have that impression that this has been increasing and raising, and perhaps we have to also focus on those that remain silent about it, but that actually are not negative about it. And maybe it's the middle term where we still need to work with them and to keep them informed and to bring these real stories and not only statistics that might continue triggering this solidarity. Meantime, I don't know if there is other comments or questions. I have the takeaways for the solutions, because one of the objectives of this webinar was what at EU level, European institutions, but also ourselves as a European network can do or can push for trying to pursue or achieve this more cohesive narrative. You were saying how different it is, how at international level people are speaking about human rights, how at national is focused on securitization, and then at local is where the citizens feel more connected to it. And these three takeaways for a more cohesive policy through those governance levels could be the investment in thematic research about the narratives that you mentioned is something that is under research right now. Promoting formats to achieve this multi-level stakeholders conversation, and there is a cross-polarization, especially local bottom-up and not international down to the local, and to monitor and evaluate those narratives. That I think this is quite a topic that we would need probably another webinar another day, because it's always difficult to monitor and to evaluate these narratives. I don't know if you have any experience on this, Marco, and especially also for a very specific things that you were mentioning in the international level, these communication bubbles. I think one, we've been working in EPIC in designing local campaigns during months, doing this persona, doing all these strategic steps on how we could reach out our audience. But still, you always have this question before you kick off your campaign. Are we going to reach out to those that are already convinced, or we will manage to go beyond that echo chamber, that silo, that communication bubble, as you mentioned, and this is something that that I think is the main worry of many campaigners that we have seen. I don't know if you have the same experience of what you have seen. Any tip that might help local campaigners to try to go beyond the persuaded ones that already are in favor of what we are saying?
Well, absolutely. So in my experience, I have never seen a campaign run by an international organization that doesn't already preach to those who already are preached. Mm-hmm. I have never seen one. I've seen it from the private sector or from individual activists. I think that the Kony 2012 campaign was an example of that. I don't know if you're familiar with that. I'd be happy to show you the video about it. But today, no. Today, most international organizations, things might change, but today, when I see the evaluation report of a campaign from a large organization, I'm not gonna drop names unless I'm requested to. Basically, the reports are based on absolute numbers. The reach of this post was X millions. This amount of people were reached. Completely useless, utterly useless. In my opinion, so whenever you're starting a campaign, you have to do three things. The first thing is get your facts in order. If you're doing a campaign about refugees, well, talk about refugees. Don't talk about the 3 million regular migrants that come into Europe regularly, safely, monitored. Because irregular migration is, over the past 10 years, less than a point percentage in Europe. So we have between 2 and 3 million people coming into the European Union every year, of which, on a 10-year scale, about 0 point X are irregular. But however, that 0 point usually takes 100% of the media coverage. So if you want to do a campaign, make it very narrow. You want to do it about refugee, try to make it as narrow as possible. Which type of refugees, where they're from, because if you're overly universal, it's just going to be another campaign in the pot of information that a stakeholder or policymaker gets. Instead, if you manage to get a specific story from a specific community, it will have a higher impact because people can relate. If you make it overly universalist, it will relate to nobody. When you target everyone, you target nobody. That's the first thing I would say. The second point is behave like someone you're listening to has something important to tell you. What I see mostly is that international campaigns from NGOs or international organizations do not address the more conservative side today. They completely ignore the fears, the concerns, the preoccupation of those who tend to think in a more conservative way, who do not live in large urban centers, who are afraid of large demographic changes that are taking place in their communities, and are completely ignored by this type of messaging. There is a piece of research that was released last year that should really show you what to do about this. It shows that those who are hyper-universalist in their value communication, they will never change their mind. Whatever you show them, they will never change their mind. Those who are more conservative are more likely to change opinion when provided with evidence. What I see when I go and speak to these forum about communicating migration, I always perceive that people think the opposite. People that come to speak to this forum think that the conservatives will never change their mind. There is research, independent research provided by the European University Institute that proves otherwise. That means that if somebody has strongly anti-immigration narratives, when provided with evidence, they are more likely to change their mind. But if your campaign goes to other people that already think that migration is great for everyone, why do you do a campaign for? It's completely useless. So, and the third point is this, don't be afraid to ask uncomfortable questions. Most of the recent debate on migration, not only on TV or online, but I would say in large fora, are very soft and tend to bring together people that already agree with each other. There's nothing worse that you can do than bring up a debate with five people, patting each other on the back, and explain how they agree on it with each other. So do get uncomfortable speakers to speak. I give you an example. The ICMPD Vienna Migration Conference is a great example of that. You can have a debate with a representative from Hungary, from Portugal, from IOM, from the European Commission at the same time. That is today, to my experience, the only type of forum where I see this kind of debate. Instead, debates on migration in large fora tend to bring people that already agree with each other, that tend to be pro-migration, and therefore they do not address the issue that they should be addressing.
Mm-hmm. So don't be afraid of asking a question and to put the concerns of those not convinced there as well, instead of trying to please ourselves. We have one participant, Rasan Ismail, that she was commenting on the chat, and I think she also wants to say something. Rasan, may you please unmute yourself?
Thank you so much. Thank you, Marco. Actually, I was with Marco in the conference last week, and we had very interesting conversations about this. So firstly, thank you, Marco, for all your remarks. It's useful. Like, it's useful information that we can actually take away and literally implement. So I did just comment in the chat about that conversation about between, you know, the third country nationals, because there are subcategories within that category, and each of them, they have a different narrative. So it's a very interesting kind of topic kind of point of view to kind of take and discuss and debate, maybe not for the forum today, but you did in that, and I thought that was quite interesting. But I wanted to also ask you about being uncomfortable with being uncomfortable, and I want to understand what would you suggest, because we all know how social media works and how the algorithm works, how, you know, confirmation bias works, and that the algorithm always pushes what you already agree with to you. So, you know, conservatives will only see what they agree with already, and liberals would only see what they agree to already. So, maybe forums can be a way, but what would you suggest? How can we reach those people that don't usually? Because if you want to invite people to a specific conference about migration, they will only be the people who care and, you know, have similar kind of ideas. So, and obviously, even with the media, like with the classic media channels today, it's almost the same. It's every single media channel has an agenda, and it's very difficult to have, you know, a non-polarizing kind of middle situated media channel. So, how do you think that we can actually reach those? And do you actually think that maybe we can, maybe it's an easier battle to win to work on the people who are not sure rather than the people that are sure in either extreme? I don't know what you think.
I love this question. And I can give a 6 hours lecture on this, because by formation, I'm a social media analyst. I was the first social media analyst of the European Commission appointed in 2012. So I'm very familiar with what you asked. The confirmation bias is true. When you go, 90% of the YouTube watched videos are suggested videos, 90%. That explains the confirmation bias. And on Facebook mostly, on Instagram today, I wouldn't know about TikTok. On Twitter, partially, you tend to receive information that corresponds to your narratives, to the way you see the world. That is absolutely true. But you, as a campaigner in this case, a campaigner meaning somebody that produces communication content that needs to be addressed to a certain audience, you have targeting criteria. So you can use targeting for your own good. And my suggestion is exactly, try to target. You can do it in two ways, either technically. So you can target your campaign, your messaging, to people that, based on their demographics, based on their likes, based on their online behavior, might be categorized under a specific box. let's say, people that don't like migrants, okay? That could be a box. So you can find that targeting Facebook is still the best platform to do that, but also Instagram gives you very interesting ways to narrow down the search so that it reaches the people you want to reach. The second thing is think of the values. And I mean, that may require another lecture, and I don't want to monopolize this, but it's very important. Some people, very broadly, some people are universalists, some people are conformists and traditionalists, okay? Whatever you think, you must accept that both values, which are not Marco Ricorda's values, they come from the work of Schwartz, which is an important sociologist in the 80s. And in 1992, he built a model with 10 macro values, of which at the fringes you have universalism, and on the other side you have security, tradition, and conformity. You have to acknowledge, if you're a universalist, that tradition, security, and conformity are legitimate values. And if you are a traditionalist, you must accept that universalism and benevolence are legitimate values. What I see, and I want to say it mostly from the universalist side, is that they don't accept that tradition, conformity, and security are legitimate. You might disagree, but they think they are illegitimate. On a macro scale, that's what I see causes a lot of polarization. I'll give you an example. In Austria, there was a fantastic campaign where it was a region of Upper Austria, where the analyst of the campaign realized that most people in that community were traditionalist conformist. They like things the way they are. If these people, and they had to do a campaign for the job inclusion of migrants, okay? They realized that, the campaigners, if they had sent universalist messages to that community, like open borders or we're all the same and we should all accept each other, very vague messaging, the message would have elicited antipathy. Instead, what did they do? They got smarter than that. They did a campaign just focusing about how migrants contribute to the job market. So they showed people coming from the Middle East, from Africa, from different parts of the world, being firefighters, being doctors, being carers, being policemen. And so they could relate more with their own values. So the idea is that if you accept that that value is legitimate, you can do value-based communication. If not, you lose them. You lose these people. And unfortunately, it's a lot easier psychologically, and there is a great book by Thomas Erickson about that. Psychologically, it's a lot easier to comfort yourself by not taking risk, because your campaign will have greater absolute results by trying to preach to the already preached, instead of trying to change people's mind. And as I said earlier, if you try to address the conservative community, you will have a higher chance than doing otherwise. I hope this somehow helps you with your question about targeting, and happy to tell you more in a follow-up should that be needed.
Thanks a lot, Marco. Yes, indeed, very useful tips for the tailoring and to go and take some risk for our campaigns so that they are like meaningful, achieving those that we really want to reach out. And thanks, Rasan, for your comments, reflection, and your question. We will continue or listen to you, Marco, for hours, but we have to continue. But I have to say, while this is the last planned webinar, we will have now, after finally the COVID, it seems, physical events happening in different locations in Europe in the next months. So we will be very happy to welcome you, to invite you again, and perhaps to keep exchanging on this topic. Thanks a lot, Marco. Now I would like to welcome our second guest keynote speech, Anila Noor, Managing Director of New Women Connectors. Hi, Anila. Well, I would like to give a brief introduction of your own expertise. You're a refugee activist based in the Netherlands with diverse experience working with national and international for-profit organizations, and you've been active in advocating for refugee resettlement and socio-political engagement of refugees in Europe. And as I said, you were, among other things, you started the New Women Connectors as a movement for striving the mainstream, the unheard voices of migrants and refugees, specifically women living across Europe. We've been speaking now for a while with Marco about the different governance levels, the different roles that institutions and organizations have in shaping these migration narratives and how they might influence migration policies. But when speaking about these migration narratives and policies, for sure, we cannot, we should not overlook the one of the most important agents of that process, which are precisely the migrants and the refugees themselves, and that very often we can see how things are designed by for them and not with them. And that's why we have the honor to have you here today, Anila, with us, to ask you if you can please set some insights with us on how we can embed this in these migration narratives and how to enable participation of migrants and refugees in decision-making process in a way that is meaningful and above all, I would say, in a way that is avoiding a tokenistic or colonialistic approach, if I may say it, and that really allow and empower migrants to be the agents that save their own narratives.
Thank you, Patricia, and thank you so much, Marcus. You really give very good, important insight, and I'm happy to be take lead from there because the idea or discussion about why we need to change the narrative. There is no, you know, more than that, what you mentioned. But I would like to say, based on our experience and being involved on the refugees representative in different level, we felt there's a mechanism, there's a space. Who has the right to say something? Who has the power over the voices? Who have the you know, resources or who have hold on audience and who has the more power to influence those audience. So this is a mechanism which we are trying to analyze and we are trying to unpack based on our lived experience as knowledge. And that's why we are creating and advocating for meaningful participation. Because since 2015, when everyone was talking about refugees, suddenly a few actors, they felt, okay, but where are these refugees, who they are, like how we can understand and bring them to the platform, and they start inviting. So refugee or migrants representation started there especially in Europe on different conferences. And I am one of the always say now I felt blessed to be part of different discussion, to be on the seat of the table. But based on my experience, I will say it was becoming more complicated when we heard we've been just invited. So there you need to understand the power or politics of space. It's very important who has the hold of these spaces. And you as a migrant refugee being invited as a beneficiary to share your stories on these spaces. So it means already you have been invited and this shared you have a mic to talk about it, and this mic will be taken away from you after this event finished. So that's why we realize it has to become a transformation of a mechanism. So this is based on that, we are advocating for meaningful participation, and we are also trying to understand how this meaningful participation should look like. How this transfer as a systematic change, a systematic understanding of mechanism where we are involving migrant and refugees, especially in Europe. Because in Europe, I will say, as also Rezan mentioned in the chat, there are so many terms being used to define who is refugee, who is migrant, who is a forced migrant and asylum seeker, stateless, there are so much. But for us, we felt people who feel still, like now I'm a Dutch, but
I'm still feeling refugee or Dutch, you know, how this define and how they give you these narratives, give you acceptance to announce it, like you are Dutch or you are still a refugee. This experience defined you, how you are facing lived realities on daily basis. And these narratives give you, you to work only as a beneficiary when we are trying, especially to change the political debate, especially trying to influence the policies discussion. So they invite you to share your stories, but they make this decision on based on your stories, again, in the closed doors. So we are trying to create open spaces to work as a co-partner, to involve as a main actor of this policy debate, and especially when it comes to the narration of narratives. Unfortunately, refugees or migrant, let's say from the displacement setting, been always been defined as a vulnerable community. And this definition of defining one community who is a vulnerable, they are not giving them to unpack their full potential. And this create a fear of burden, especially in Europe. And this burden of fear, okay, it's a few people, few community, a group are coming who has no knowledge, who has no expertise to share. And this fear of burden create more complex discussions, complex, freedom, fear of unknown. And this fear of unknown being used with those people who are not in the favor of migration in Europe. So we need to understand how this all intertagged and embedded with each other. So that's why what we are doing, especially with our different communities leaders, we are trying to change. We are partners. We have a seat on the table. We are not only beneficiaries, and vulnerabilities being put because of the system. It's not a vulnerability of a community. It's not a vulnerability of a person, especially for women, especially from the children or elderly. We need to show our involvement based on being a resilient, being an actor, being a main component of the discussion. It's simple. It's a very easy. It's not a rocket science. If you want something, you need to address directly to me. You need to have the access even to explain that, like what you want and how you want to be involved. And we need to showcase and recognize what has been changed. But unfortunately, recent Ukraine crisis showed again, like how we are somehow being put of competition of vulnerabilities. Who is vulnerable, who is not, who is a refugee, right? Has a right to be a refugee and who is not. So this is very important to understand. And second, about, as I mentioned, we are talking about four main component and or angles. One is voices, who have the right to even to share my voices, you know, who has the audience to say something, who has the mic to say what. And these narratives need to be understand what we are see in our newspaper, in our digital media, especially in our social media. These voices been saying one side of the story. We need to come unpack to share more stories from the life experience. That's why we are involving migrant refugee women, especially because being a woman, this barrier become more and more difficult to tackle. So we are giving them encouragement, training, so they can share their stories in a meaningful way. And what does it mean in a meaningful way? Meaningful way, they are not taken as a beneficiary or one community of target community, but they are showed how they are identify what is the problem, how they come up with the solution, what is the solution and what they want to achieve and how. So there's need to be understanding of this participation. If I say we use always ladder of participation, so we are trying to say this ladder of participation have the mechanism of power and control. And we are trying to change and tackle that by using this ladder of participation. There have been communities who been always been invited, manipulated by using their stories. But how we are trying, okay, now we want to be not only being involved on invited basis, but we want to co-create this spaces. And we want to co-create this information audience. So we have our audience who do understand, like when There are so many, especially nowadays, in different actors like yours, they are involving migrant and refugee representative, but there are still so many actors who only invite you as an expert from the non-migrant background person as an expert, but not inviting migrant and refugee as expert. So it's again, she shows how we are inviting just to share their stories, you know, of flee or how integration or resettlement, but they are not inviting them as expert. So that's what we are trying to change. Second, what we are trying to change, this involvement so far in Europe especially is based on consultations. So migrant refugees being informed or invited to give a feedback, to share their input based on some kind of already designed structure. So we've been invited even to part of these consultations, and we don't know what happened before and what will gonna happen after our consultation, after our input. So we are saying, and we produce research, and we are reflecting on this mechanism of consultation, like how we can even beyond go to this consultation mechanism. And because if this consultation is happening again and again, again, it goes back the first letter of manipulation, tokenization. So that's what we are trying to understand when we are saying meaningful participation, we are asking for a systematic change. And I know change is difficult, change is hard, change is not easy. But if we realize this is a problem, I think we have a more success than other. Because unfortunately, still we are not understanding or realizing the problem start as soon as you define migrant or refugee only as a beneficiary. And the mechanism is not giving more flexibilities. So we say, okay, how we can work with migrant-led or refugee-led organization or initiative, because they are not registered, they are not working. And we you know, keep inviting them on a very limited space. So this creates more tokenism, and long-term effect becomes short-term. So we need to understand that. From last few months, we've been analyzing the meaningful participation, understanding on different actors globally, and especially in European, and new women connectors come like a grid, like a system, so we can understand what kind of narratives, what kind of engagement is harmful when refugee and migrant only been informed. There's a harmful step we need to realize, and we need to notify this is harm. As also Marco said, sometime in this kind of domain, this kind of discussion is become uncomfortable, because you are criticizing, and criticizing is difficult to understand. So we are trying to make a mutual understanding, like why we want this kind of setup, because we really want a long-term impact for a good welcoming Europe, which is difficult. And second grade, which we are saying how we can neutralize our understanding, you know, how this is become like a natural way of procedure. So even like today is a refugee week, and after a few years, we don't need to define or advocate for refugees. It's become like part of the system, but unfortunately, still we are advocating a gender intersectional approach when we are talking about refugee crisis, when we are talking about displacement crisis. So it shows like there's a long, long way to go. Then we are also advocating for creating a sensitivity, sensitization about how we can talk about this engagement of migrants. And then we are also trying to advocate how much we are responsive and how we are ready to transformative, because these engagements is need to be infinity approach, and it should be involve different actors on different levels. But it should be created based on this infinity approach, which shared knowledge, which shared expertise, and recognized. Unfortunately, so far, migrant and refugee involvement is not being recognized that much it should be. And our worry is like, we already have climate crisis gonna happen in the future. And we don't know who will become a refugee or who will be displaced person. And this narrative, which is happening, they are thinking, and they are just, putting the picture of those people who are on the boats. As soon as this kind of narrative, this kind of images, we don't realize anyone can become refugee. It's not a specific community who is only refugee and who only need our help, but need to understand how we can make it a normal term, normal norm. So we don't need to advocate, but unfortunately it's a long way to go. And I just want to finish by saying that we are here as a newcomer, we are here as a new partner, and we need to understand to realize our potential so we could contribute more and more, but it's require a systematic change, which is a long way to go.
Thanks a lot, Anila, for this presentation, for these ideas about the meaningful participation and this message of how we need to have this systemic change and this infinitive model in which people are not just consulted and addressed as beneficiaries. What do you think, Anila, in your view, are the main limitations for, specifically maybe for public institutions to, I understand this systemic change, as you said, it takes time, it is risky, it entails a lot of things, but you need to start from somewhere. You need to start little by little. We know that the European Commission, the EHOM, has been funded some pilot projects in this direction that maybe in the future are like bringing some examples that can be scaled up or transferred to other municipalities. But what do you think is the main limitations for this change to happen? Is the fear? Is the willingness? Is budget constraints? What do you think it is, Anila?
I will say, Patricia, it's a mix of everything. There is a lack of resources. There is a lack of recognition, and also it's difficult because if the pattern is so much set in our system, like it's difficult to unpack. And as I mentioned, if we identify what is a problem, then already we have achieved so much, but we are not realizing where is the barrier. We are not accepting that this is even a barrier. To work directly with migrant refugee-led initiative is becoming a barrier. And because it's easy to blame because we don't have a system, you don't have a structure. So that's the thing we are asking for, to change a systematic change. This is one thing. And second also, we need to understand the need of working with the intersectional approach to work with a feminist or gender-based approach, because in Europe, being a woman from South Asian culture, it was a shock for me, and still I'm trying to advocate for how we can bring more gender-sensitive approach as a cross-cutting theme instead of bringing about a woman as a second thought, but to bring their experience, their voices in the system as a main-centric approach. Because this then again goes beyond to generation. That's still missing, and I think this is a very important discussion which you are happening. It's like how we can exchange our ideas, as expertise, and even understanding of different approaches. That's really neat. I think this mechanism can be enhanced if we can create more and more platform to exchange this dialogue on an equal level as a partner.
Thanks a lot, Anila. Equal level as a partner and taking into account this intersectionality, because of course every person is different, and some people within vulnerable groups might be affected by different realities. We must for sure keep into account when designing the policies, such as the gender approach, as you rightly pointed. Thanks a lot again, Anila. Okay, so now, last but definitely not least, I would like to welcome our third and last speaker for today's webinar, Francisco Ramirez, who is a social worker and management technician of the General Director of Social Services and Relations with the Third Sector for the region of Murcia. Welcome, Francisco, and good morning, good afternoon now at this point today.
Thank you, Patricia. Hello, everyone. And thanks for the invitation to this very interesting webinar. So I have prepared a short presentation about how it's going in Murcia, our experience developing an anti-discrimination campaign in the frame of for participation in RAGIN, Regions for Migrants and Refugees Integration, a very interesting, and in my opinion, a very successful project funded by European Commission and perfectly coordinated by the CRPM. So I'm going to share my screen.
Yes, please go ahead. And RAGIN was funded by us in Migration Integration, so it's one of the sibling projects, as we said, funded at the same call as EPIC. So we are very pleased to learn more now that you have achieved the end and to learn for the results of those pilot projects in Murcia.
Okay, so. Well, this is Murcia, my region. Murcia is located in the southeast of Spain. And well, of course, you all are invited to visit us whenever you want. I work in the regional administration in the general direction of social services and relationship with the third sector, specifically in the social volunteering immigration service. As I said, RAGIN has been a great experience for us and an opportunity to think about our integration or migrants integration policies, to reflect about it and improve as possible our public inclusion services policies. It's a project that sadly ends last month. We miss it, we learn a lot. And this was the RAGIN partnership, the CPMR as a leader, six regional partners, including Murcia, and three technical partners in strategies and CIGOP from Catalonia, Spain, and MPG from Brussels, Belgium. Well, from the beginning, the RAGIN project dynamics and methodology has made us to reinforce the participatory strategies based on partnership. And in this sense, we try to follow this way to address the development of this institutional campaign with an stakeholder approach. Once the stakeholder have been properly identified and properly engaged at the regional level, we organize an online event under the name of Proposals for Integration. And in this workshop or capacity building session, we worked together to, first of all, identify the main threats and weaknesses of our integration policies. Also our strengths and opportunities, and then launch proposals to improve them and that could be addressed in a collaborative way with the several stakeholders. It really was a very interesting and enriching day for all, a day for shared reflection and to look for gaps for improvement with more than 30 attendees for groups working using short methodology, a great experience. And as can be seen in this slide, some of the most voted proposal, specifically the second one and the third one, were directly related to the development of awareness actions. And the first one points at funding these policies with the incorporation to the new operational regional program. In this point, we try to connect this initiative with the Regional Forum of Immigration. This regional forum is an administrative body, an administration body, an advisory and participatory body. That depends on our social policy department, which are represented the main entities, civil society, NGOs, municipalities, union, university, public services, et cetera. It's for us an important space where discuss about the several issues related with the migration phenomenon and the challenge of migration and refugees integration. This forum works in plenary and in commission. And in our case, we created a specific commission with a technical profile to promote and work on the chosen proposals, the design and development of anti-discrimination campaign, and incorporation of integration policies in the new regional operational program that define the access to the new European social fund. As we can see here, we wanted to get more sustainability to the initiative beyond Reading, linking them with a consolidated administrative structure of the region of Murcia. Today, it has met 7 times online and in person to respond to the tasks entrusted by the forum. And well, at first I was only going to talk about the campaign, but Patricia asked me to also explain the other initiative. So I have included some more slides. This is the first one. And well, the idea is defining lines for the incorporation of integration public policies in the new ESF Plus. One of the proposals that very opportunely were made in the stakeholder participation session, and the one that obtained the highest score, was to carry out joint work to try to incorporate policies for the first time into the operational regional program, which define the public policies to which the cohesion funds are allocated. One of the great weaknesses identified in integration policy at the regional level was the lack of clear and stable financial support, which is why the possibility of securing multi-year financing in the 2021-2027 period, in my opinion, was welcomed with great interest by all the parties involved. And well, in this sense, to achieve the objective, there was a double task to carry out. On the one hand, to elaborate an agreed technical document which could serve as a basis for the definition and adjustment to the new ESF Plus regulation. And on the other hand, a political awareness work to show and assert the importance of these public policies so that the region bets on them as part of its long-term strategy. In this process, we had the collaboration of strategies, an entity specialized in European affairs, mobility, migration and diversity management, technical partner of the Reading project, and who joined in the commission meetings. At the moment, although the development of the operational program is still underway, we are very happy, we are very satisfied because our colleagues from the European Program Service have already confirmed that we will have a budget allocated specifically for the inclusion of migrants and refugees in our region. So great news for us. And we are already working on the development and establishment of indicators and on the design of the different lines of financing, which we hope will reach to municipalities and entities of the third sector of social action. We hope to be able to start promoting coexisting and social inclusion projects in the different territories, co-financed between the ESF Plus and Region of Murcia, starting next year. Well, going back to the anti-discrimination campaign, I'm going to tell now about the steps taken from this point for the development of the campaign. And well, with the stakeholder-based strategy in mind, in the call for tender process, we underline the importance of submitting technical proposal with a participatory approach. Once the marketing company was chosen, once the contract was signed, work began with the commission through dynamics and workshop to try to collect the different sensitivities, ideas, proposals, and approaches. And with these inputs, with this collected information, will be the basis, will be the guidelines for the design of the creative concept of the campaign. In our case, all the members of this commission, of this task force, point out the importance of alert population and raise awareness of hate speech. Sadly, every day more present in our society, in media, and especially in social network, in many cases directly related to the rejection of the immigrant refugees. Next, the marketing company made several proposals with the guidance provided, and the one that was finally chosen by the regional government was raised back to the regional forum for immigration for get contribution of the member and for the validation of the member represented during. Finally, the campaign Real Reality Glasses was validated, and then the process of developing deliverables, the commercial or audiovisual spot itself, element for radio, social network, etc. I began. Okay, here just a picture about the second round of the stakeholder capacity building session celebrated in the regional forum for immigration when the campaign and the strategic lines was validated. In the table, Lucía Hernández, my general director, next to her, Maite Muñoz, the head of my service, stakeholder in the crowd, Saray Espejo from strategies in the screen. And here, some notes about the anti-discrimination campaign. Obviously, after the development of advertising materials, there remains a no less important part, the dissemination plan in the media. In our case, the central element of the campaign was an audiovisual spot, of which several versions were recorded with political representatives and personalities from Murcia society to launch a clear message against hate speech and racial prejudice. When this spot was broadcast for a few weeks on TV, the message began to be reinforced through other media, like radio, press, poster, etc. Several entities represented in the Regional Forum for Immigration collaborated in the dissemination process through their own website and social networks. Our region collaborated financially, assuming the cost of dissemination the campaign in the different media. And we are currently in the process of assessing its impact. And there is a clear demand to keep, as a regional administration, to keep this kind of awareness rising action over time. Okay, so next to finish my presentation, I'm going to show you the spot. In this case, starring by Madi Ziseba, a regular collaborator of us, president of the Federation of African Associations in Murcia. I'm sorry because I couldn't subtitle it in English, but I hope it understood from the context. The spot begins with a series of posts on social network containing false information with a sadly typical message such as immigrants have a free house or they come to steal our jobs. And then show an invented product, the Real Reality Glasses, that allow you to see the reality asset is free from manipulation. And the spot ends with the message that this product doesn't exist, but racisms and hate messages do. And it's important to be able to identify them, to avoid them, and not allow ourselves to be manipulated. Okay, so let's play it.
Los inmigrantes tienen casa gratis.
Si te gusta
molestan tanto,
acógelos en tu casa.
No quieren integrarse.
No vienen del hambre.
Vienen a hacer.
Provoca un efecto llamado.
Van por tus hijos.
Van por tus hijos. Nos quitan el trabajo.
Los inmigrantes ilegales son demasiados.
Son demasiados.
¿Problemas para distinguir entre lo que es real y lo que es falso? Nuevas gafas de realidad real. Descubra un mundo libre de fake news gracias a su alta sensibilidad a la información manipulada. Cero Fake. Consiga ya las nuevas gafas de realidad real y elimine por completo los discursos de odio de todas sus redes. Porque el primer paso para solucionar un problema es ver que existe.
Este producto no existe. El racismo sí. No te creas todo lo que leas.
Gobierno de la Región de Murcia.
Well, this has been, in short, our experience so far trying to create a positive narrative regarding immigration. Thank you very much for listening. This PowerPoint is at your disposal if anyone is interested. And thanks again for the invitation. For my part, it's all.
Thank you, Francisco. Thank you for the presentation, for closing with this video. Indeed, that's the advertisement said the reality glasses doesn't exist. We need to be ourselves, the campaigners and the promoters, raising the awareness. And I'm happy to see that that the committee, the forum for immigration, is actually something that you mentioned is going to be beyond the regime project, so beyond the funded. Yeah. It's something sustainable. It's something we are right now also discussing in EPIC. We've been developing a lot of efforts of, as usual, in design these pilots, and how to make them sustainable after the end of the project is always a key question, something that that is challenging quite often. I would like to give the floor again to Rasan. Hi, Rasan. Can
you please, I'm always the one with the questions.
Please,
so firstly, go ahead. Thank you so much, Francisco. Muchas gracias. So, I mean, I'm actually a big fan of the Regine project, and I've been following their work for a while. And I think it's a great initiative, and sustainability is always an issue, I think, with these funded projects. And I am very happy to hear that it's gonna continue. So I just had a couple questions. So firstly, when you do the stakeholder mapping, and I go back to what Anila was talking about participation, and I can tell you as a myself, I founded an association in Barcelona, and it's very difficult to, there are structural barriers to reach higher levels and engage with the municipalities and the authorities. So was there any proactive outreach to the migrant-led organizations or migrants? Were they part of the stakeholder kind of capacity building, I would say? Was there, again, I want to say there are a lot of open spaces, but access is always an issue, whether it be for language barriers, whether it be for structural barriers, like being, you know, registered, or there are several barriers to that. So I'm always an advocate for a proactive outreach to those stakeholders. So firstly, has there been any stakeholder kind of active outreach? That's one thing. And the second thing is, were there any, I want to say, accountability or kind of feedback measures? So, and that also, I think, will lead to my following question, which is, I want to ask Marco, how do you actually measure the impact of an advocacy campaign? So I just, Marco, FYI, kind of want to send that question to you, because impact measurement is also very important, and I would love to know how. But for Francisco, before that, were there any like feedback mechanisms of how it's going? Did you receive feedback from the community? Were there any channels to get that kind of
Evaluation of the impact of the campaign.
Yes. Like, how did you measure it? How did you? Were there any like collection of responses, of reactions? Do you have anything in particular that you applied?
It's difficult to ask for us because we are not specializing in marketing issues, so only have information right now regarding the media plan as the number of broadcasts or publication in the media. Or we have received some congratulations regarding the initiative, and but our idea is to evaluate, I guess, in a qualitative way, to evaluate into the commission and in the regional forum for immigration, trying to keep this communication, this institutional communication, beyond Beijing next year, and trying to obtaining this feedback from the members, or from the stakeholders, members of this regional forum and commission, a specific commission. In this moment is our idea, but it's difficult to evaluate, to assess the impact in a society level of this kind of initiative, but we currently are in this point. Thank you.
Yes, there are ways to do that. First of all, the definition of the goal. What is the goal of the campaign? Is it to change attitudes? Is it to increase knowledge? Is it to do what? So the first thing is to define very clearly the goal. And the second one, it would be to then assess the goal with surveys. For instance, if you're assessing attitudes, there are surveys that help you to do that. If you're assessing knowledge, it is the same. The second way is also to, as I mentioned earlier, use analytics to predict behavioral change. You can do that. You can get a behavioral scientist, an academic, that can do that for you. It's hard to do at a large scale. This is why I would do it today, also because it's very expensive. I mean, surveys are expensive, and behavioral science is not easy and cheap to implement, and it takes a lot of time. But the more you do it, the cheaper it gets, demand and supply. But the second one is to analyze analytics, not in terms of absolute numbers, but to see based on online behavior, if the profiles you're addressing, because you can create personas that can be identified as a conservative, a liberal, a universalist, or a traditionalist, to see whether their attitude or knowledge has changed. So there are ways to do it. Now, today, as an analyst, any assessment that doesn't do this is not helpful. Any report that says numbers, reach, number of comments, to be very honest, academically, is useless. So I would say try to do a campaign on a very small target. A city is fine, can be the city of, or even an area of a city, but then you have to assess and monitor the change through either service analytics or behavioral science. Otherwise, you will end up in the same cycle. I've been part of a group that analyzed large campaigns by, I can say, IOM. Campaigns that cost millions of euros, and the appointed evaluators concluded that these campaigns were not effective. So I'll leave it at that. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Marco. Indeed, very, very important point to consider the evaluation of the campaigns, I think, from the very beginning, and to when you are designing the strategy, to consider the goal and who is your persona, and narrow down and tailor it, and start to think from the very beginning how you are going to ask these people what is the perception that they are receiving, besides those statistics of number of views and other figures that we can get through analytics. So Francisco was saying also the qualitative part and not only the quantitative. We are time up only almost, but there was this question that Rassan was also asking you, Francisco, very briefly about the outreach for the forum, specifically for the, we were speaking about meaningful participation, about the mainstreaming the voices of migrants and refugees directly in these spaces of the multi-governance spaces, and how was your outreach campaign, if there was also to try to identify community refugee-led organization, migrant representatives as part of this stakeholder mapping that you did, or maybe this is something that you can still do since the forum is been made sustainable.
Well, in my experience, in this kind of action, is easier to engage maybe the entities work directly with migrants and refugees, or the migrants association in itself, the Department of Social Services in the municipalities. I understand that is because they are closer to the needs and problem of migrants and situation of social vulnerability. The regular administrative situation is often a barrier, a handicap to access to public resources and services. Perhaps you need to more effort, you need to try harder to engage stakeholders from private sector, for example, companies, business world. You have to try harder to understand the importance of its presence and its contribution in these forums. Although I must say that in our case, we have been fortunate to have the collaboration of many colleagues from different departments and areas of the regional government. Very, very important to create spaces as the regional forum to gather stakeholders to discuss together about, for example, the forum is being very important these days in the Ukrainian crisis situation. It's the space to try to collaborate, to coordinate the different municipalities and different public services, trying to offer an adequate response, no, to the crisis. It's important to try to get the maximum number of stakeholders, but that's my point.
Thank you, Francisco. Yeah, well, in this you said it takes a lot of efforts, and okay, there's for sure barriers, but I can see for what you said that you've been trying to tackle those barriers to make it inclusive, mm-hmm, and representative. So please keep going, because I think we need this model to be spread around other cities. So I'm very happy that we got to have you here with us today to learn more about the regime, and hopefully we will have you also in other upcoming events.
Okay,
so we exceed our time, but thank you everybody for having been here till the end. I hope you all find the presentations and the debate inspiring, that you got some nice takeaways for your campaigns and for your daily work. We will be in touch with you through a feedback form, also for monitoring and evaluation, and also feel free to follow the EPICAMIF project for the upcoming information on the pilots that we are also doing, on the 8 local campaigns, newsletters, and physical events that we will be doing in the second semester of 2022, in different European countries. Thanks a lot, everybody, to Marco, Francisco, Anila, especially, but to all the attendees. Take good care and have a nice day. Bye-bye.
Thank you.